chapter 10, the passage of scripture that was read earlier for meditation, Mark chapter 10, reading verse 17, and let's stop just before, we won't go through the entire thing that was read for scripture meditation. I'll take a piece of this passage, which I will use to lay the foundation for the message that is entitled today, Good is Not Enough. Good is not enough. Mark chapter 10, verse 17, and we read, and as Jesus was setting out on a journey, a man ran up to him and knelt before him and began asking him, Good teacher, what shall I do to inherit eternal life? And Jesus said to him, Why do you call me good? No one is good except God alone. You know the commandments. Do not murder, do not commit adultery, do not steal, do not bear false witness, do not defraud, honor your father and your mother. And he said to him, Teacher, I have kept all these things from my youth up. And looking at him, Jesus felt a love for him and said to him, One thing you lack. There is one version that says, One thing thou lackest. That's the King James Version. Go and sell all of your possession, all that you possess, and give it to the poor. And you shall have treasures in heaven, and come and follow me. Last verse. But at these words, his face fell, and he went away grieved, for he was one who owned much property. Please bow your heads with me as we pray. Our gracious God and our loving Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for the many blessings that you have bestowed upon us. Today, as we open your words, we pray that you'll open our hearts as we tabernacle with you and with one another. We pray today that your Holy Spirit will draw close to us to bless, to guide. I pray, oh God, that we'll be edified today, motivated, lifted up from where we are, that our feet may be planted on higher and solid ground. We pray today that your words will saturate our minds to transform them so that we will be like you. We want to be like Jesus. This coming to church is a part of the journey that you have for us. God, there is a destination as we sang this morning. We are marching to Zion. Beautiful, beautiful Zion. We're marching upwards to Zion, that beautiful city of God. Lord, we do not want to pray and praise and come to church every day, and at the end of the day, we're castaways. We want to hear from your lips, well done. We want to make it into your kingdom. Lord, we pray that your Holy Spirit will do a great work in us, through us, Amen. With us. We pray that we will have an anointing. We pray that there will be something special that will start and happen with us. Oh God, we live in a world today where men and women are going to a Christless grave around us, left, right, and center. We pray, God, that we will have the influence and impact lives before they hit the grave. Oh God, we pray that we ourselves will recognize that divine power is available to us. And Jesus, that we will be connected as we studied this morning in our Sabbath school. Connected so that, Lord, we can shine in a dark world, in a dark place. We have a message to go forward. And we pray, oh God, that we ourselves will be that message. We would be like Bibles seen and read of men and women, Jesus, who have never been with you. Oh God, may our presence be your presence. So we pray today, Jesus, that we'll just tap into you one more time. And for me, this feeble of clay whom you have used so many times before today, I pray one more time that you'll use me, that you'll mold me, that you'll fashion me, that Jesus, your Holy Spirit, will just work. Then when all of this is over, when church is over, and we We long for that day when you will come again. Oh God, we pray that all of us who are here, along with family members and friends, we will all have the joy to go home to live with you forever. Is our prayer with thanksgiving. In Jesus' name, amen. Good is not enough, Brother Elkin. Good is just not enough. It's just not enough. You know, I saw a quote, and the quote said, the biggest enemy to greatness is actually good. Because if you settle with good, then you probably think then that is good enough. You never become great. The greatest enemy of greatness is good. Just being good. That's the biggest enemy to greatness. And as I was preparing this message, I remembered a conversation that I had a long time ago with a friend of mine, just soon after I became a Christian. I remember this conversation. This was an old friend of mine. She was fascinated at my choice of becoming a Christian. She was fascinated. Some people were shocked. And I'm almost sure that in your experience, when you decide to make your calling and election sure, there were some who were shocked. But she was fascinated at the choice that I made. And of course, you know, when people are at that place where they want to know what's going on with you, why did you make this move, and why did you become a Christian? What prompted you to make this decision? While I was sharing what I felt, the calling in my life. You know, we share that call in our life. I was sharing the calling of my life. In the middle of all of that, she blurted out. And I will never forget it. In the middle of me telling about my calling and what was happening in my life, she blurted out this question: do you know the sacrifices that you have to make when you become a Christian? And I paused for a moment, and her name was Candy, and I said to myself, can you imagine Candy's interrogating me about my decision while she's just living her own life? But she, in the midst of me explaining, she said, do you know that you have to leave your house and your mother and your father and brother and sister and leave everything behind? And you know, when somebody's saying that to you, you know, you're not really getting what they're saying, but and then she's not a Christian, so it never came home to me as if this was something that was serious, but she asked me the question nonetheless. She asked me, do you know that you have to make sacrifice? You gotta leave this, you gotta leave that, you gotta leave this, you gotta leave that. And in my head, while she's talking, I'm checking off all the things that I can leave or what I can afford to leave. In my head, I'm checking. I could leave house, but then the truth is I never had a house to leave. And so that wasn't a big challenge to me. And I went down the list. You have to leave mother, and you have to leave father, you have to leave brother, and you have to leave sister. In the midst of all of this, Kelly, she said, you have to leave everything to follow Jesus. And I don't know if that is something that you have ever given thought to as you think about this whole journey and following Jesus and walking with Jesus, that Jesus, when he calls you into this relationship where he is expecting that you will leave everything to come to him. But for me, as a young Christian, I was just about 18. It was about a couple of days before my 18th birthday. Not a couple. It was actually the day before my 18th birthday that I actually got baptized. For me, looking around, I saw everybody who were Christians. They were still living in their homes. They were still with mother, and they're still with father, and they were still with houses, and they were still doing all these things that God is asking us to leave in order to follow him. It wasn't until I really started to walk with God that I realized what God was really saying to me as a Christian. And I'm sharing this as my experience, it wasn't really until I really started to walk with God, Shakira, that I understood when Jesus says to the disciples and to all those who he was trying to reach, those who were wanting to follow him, when he says, you have to leave every single thing in order to follow me. It wasn't until I was in board meeting and people were just going off on me that I realized, or in members meeting, business meeting, when people were just having their own way, that I really realized what Jesus was saying to me, that if you're going to follow me and if you're going to be a successful walking with me, then you have to leave everything. You have to leave your attitudes behind. You have to leave your will behind. You have to leave the things that you will normally do and the way that you will normally act. And you have to leave all of that behind. When you look at this story, it's almost as if you get a picture, Julie, that Jesus is picking on rich people. But that's not what Jesus is doing. Because there's absolutely nothing wrong with riches. And it might shock you that there is nothing wrong with riches, really. Jesus gave riches. God gave riches. Solomon was one of the richest guys around. So there's nothing wrong with riches. What Jesus was really saying when he talked about when he said how hard it will be for those who are wealthy to enter the kingdom of God, he was really making an observation. He had observed that all the people who had money, all that money did, the tendency of having a lot of money, the tendency is to make you more of who you really are. And that's a challenge that Jesus is having with riches. It's not that riches is a bad thing. But he's saying that people who, what riches will do, riches, the tendency of having riches will just make you more. It will bring out who you really are. Because, so if you love spending when you had no money, now that you have money, you go on a shopping spree. That's what riches will do. If you were a gambler, now you don't just do small dealings, but now you find yourself in Vegas. Because you have the money to spend. If you were mean before you had money, now that you have money, do you think you're going to get kind overnight? You stay up all night trying to figure out how to make more money, and you spend all your time trying to figure out how I'm going to keep all this money, and how am I going to get around people who stand up and ask me for my money? It's like the pastor who had this rich congregation. He was very, very, very timid, Mike. He never wanted to go in front of his congregation and ask for any money. Very, very timid. But the treasurer came to him. You know how treasurers normally come to the pastor and let you know how much you were in the red. So he came to the pastor, the treasurer, and said, Pastor, you have to go and you have to make some appeals. You have to ask for some money. We are in the red. So the pastor goes in front of his congregation. He stands up with a smile on his face. And he said, today, congregation, I have good news and I have bad news. The brethren shouted back, Pastor, give us the good news. Give us the good news, Pastor. Give us the good news. And he said, well, we have all the money we need to pay off our mortgage. And we have all the money we need to pay all of our bills and do all the ministries in this church. Then he paused. And somebody said, what's the bad news, Pastor? Give us the bad news. And he said, well, the money is in your pockets. When Jesus told the rich young ruler what he told him, for him it was bad news. The truth is that this rich young ruler, he wasn't a bad person. Not at all. Think about it. If he was a bad guy, would he go to Jesus and ask Jesus how could he inherit eternal life. Jesus was going about his business. He was the one who left everything that he was doing, ran before Jesus, knelt before Jesus, and said to Jesus, Jesus, tell me how, what it is that I can do to inherit eternal life. And look at how he addressed Jesus. He said, good teacher, tell me. Because just like I told you the last time, that a disciple is always trying to find the best teacher. He's looking at Jesus as a good teacher. The first problem he was having was that he did not recognize Jesus as Lord. He recognized Jesus as just another good teacher walking around teaching all these things so he could attach himself, because Jesus was becoming a popular teacher. So he says, good teacher. He was looking for good. As a matter of fact, he was looking for the best. Every disciple was trying to attach themselves to the best teacher that they could possibly attach themselves to. The better the teacher, the more popular he will be, the more credentials he will have to climb the social ladder. So that's the idea. It's like us today trying to find the best school. Everybody wants to get into Harvard. Everybody wants to get into Yale and Princeton and University of Chicago, because you know that when you leave, you have the credentials that can get you into any door. So this was all that he was doing. He wasn't a bad guy. He was a good guy. From he was young, he was doing all these things. The young ruler saw Jesus as a moral man, a man of insight and depth, but he did not recognize that Jesus was divine. And that was where his problem started. Because he was just seeking, you know, he was seeking for the right thing. Because he wanted to know how to inherit eternal life. But he never recognized that Jesus was divine, that Jesus was the Son of God. See you, Jesus, and not know who he is.
Yeah, wow.
And the challenge that Christianity is facing today, not just Seventh-day Adventists, but Christendom in general, is that Christendom is following this idea of a religion, a Christianity, but they really and truly don't spend the time to know who Jesus is. Because if you don't know who you're following, and that's why you can join a church, and that's why you can do this, and that's why you can do that, and that's why you can get a label, and that's why you want to be called this. But the truth is, we have to know, if we're disciples, who we are really following. You've got to know that Jesus is a way maker.
Amen.
You got to know that. But in knowing that Jesus is a way maker, you got to know that sometimes he will make the way plain, and then sometimes, Al, he's going to take you at the crossroad where you don't know if you're to turn left or you're to turn right, if you're to go forward or you're to retreat, or you're just to stand there and see the salvation of your God. You got to know who Jesus is if you're going to follow Jesus. Because if you don't see what you're looking for, the truth is, you're going to be disappointed. You're going to be discouraged. You're going to want to turn in everything. You want to throw in the towel, and you're going to leave. If you're going to be a successful disciple future, you got to know, you got to spend time. It's pointless to just be following and don't know who you're following and where he's leading you. You got to know who Jesus is. Got to know that he's Lord. And when we talk about Jesus being Lord, we're not talking about Jesus being Lord some of the times, but we're talking about Jesus being Lord all of the times. He's not Lord over some of your decisions. You're not going to pick and choose which decision you make as opposed to the decision that you allow God to make. But he becomes Lord over every single decision that you make. He is not Lord because we said it. He is Lord because from everlasting to everlasting, he is God. We got to know that Jesus is Lord. was facing was that he knew the commandments, but he never knew himself. He knew what he was supposed to do. He knew the commandments. He knew them back and front. He could explain them. He could tell you about them. But he did not know himself. And when you are following Jesus, you got to make time not just to know Jesus, but to know yourself. But to know yourself. His focus was on being good. And look at what Jesus does. Jesus meets him where he was. He meets you and I where we are. You know the commandments, Jesus says. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not bear false witness. You shall not defraud. You shall honor your mother and your father. All these commandments, they're dealing with being good. And Jesus meets him on his ground. Jesus doesn't even go to the first four. He just stays with the last six. Because all of his life, he was trying to do the last six. He was trying to be a good Christian. He was trying to be a good person, but it is not enough just simply to be good. He's focusing on the last six. He's focusing on building relationships with others. And if he can not steal and not kill and not commit adultery, then he can be seen as a good, upstanding person in society. And that was his focus, and that was the problem. Jesus didn't even mention the first four. You should have no other gods. You should not make idols. He didn't even mention the first four because if he was focusing on a relationship with God, he would have known that Jesus was the Son of God. He would have known that this is the same God who was up on the mountain with Moses, writing them commandments with his own fingers, but he wasn't focusing on building a relationship with God so that he can have the right relationship with men. All he was focusing on is to be a good person. I'm going to focus on these six that will make me a good, upstanding person in society. But he missed the entire picture, because before you can be a good, upstanding person in society, you first have to be a good, upstanding person with God. God has to look down.